Well, joining us now is former Trump National Security Advisor John Bolton. Ambassador Bolton, thanks for joining us. The actual news itself, the possibility of a meeting between Kim Jong-un and President Putin and Kim leaving North Korea to travel to Russia, what does that tell you?
Well, I think this is a big win for Kim Jong-un and the North Koreans in virtually every respect, certainly in the PR aspect of it, but in the ties that it will help increase between North Korea and Russia. It's mutually beneficial to both in Russia getting weapons and ammunition. It opens the possibility of a kind of conveyor belt. If China doesn't want to supply weapons directly, it can supply them to North Korea, and then lo and behold, they could then in turn be supplied to Russia. But from Kim's point of view, for years and years of being dependent on China, for example, people estimate North Korea gets 90% of its oil from China. Now he's got a real possibility to open up oil and gas coming from Russia. And in this complex relationship between Russia and China, while they're clearly growing closer and closer, Russia's worried about China's aspirations in the region. For example, the critical naval base and port city of Vladivostok, right to the east of North Korea, was ruled by China as recently as the mid-19th century. So Putin gains by tightening the relationship between North Korea and Russia. Kim Jong-un gains now by being able to play the two of them off against each other, as his grandfather used to do back in the days of the Cold War. And overall, I think it's another example of the U.S. being asleep while significant geopolitical developments are underway.
You think the U.S. is asleep? You're talking about the Biden administration?
Well, I'm talking about many Americans. I mean, look, I think the pursuit of the effort to get a nuclear deal with North Korea, now three decades long, has proven to be a complete waste of time. I think this recent story about Kim and Putin should tell us how significant it is that we focus on the end of North Korea, not dealing with North Korea, but the reunification of the peninsula.
So, Ambassador Bolton, you talked about oil and what getting oil from Russia could mean for North Korea, but what about the weapons technology that North Korea wants from Russia? If it gets what it wants on those fronts, what is the immediate risk to the West and the more long-term risk?
Well, I think North Korea has been receiving clandestine assistance on missiles and the nuclear programs from China and Russia for a long time. They used to admit it. In recent years, they've denied it. I'm not sure those denials are credible. The North Korean missile force is based on Russian-supplied technology, formerly Scud missiles. But the potential now is very significant, because while North Korea has demonstrated both that it can detonate nuclear devices and that it can fire missiles that have a range to hit the continental United States, it has not yet demonstrated it has the targeting capability to hit the places it aims at, or necessarily the technology to bring a nuclear weapon back into the atmosphere in a warhead that's secure enough that it's not destroyed on reentry. Russia obviously has both those capabilities. I'm sure that's what North Korea wants.
Ambassador, can I circle back to what you said about the idea of the end of people being asleep at the wheel or asleep at the switch to some degree, and the end of North Korea being kind of the necessary outcome at this point, not whatever has been happening, I think, over several administrations, several decades at this point. I guess my question is, how does that happen, right? If you look at allies in the region, while many people look at the current administration's policy as being the Indo-Pacific policy as being entirely China-based, when you look at the relationship between Japan and South Korea, that has formed and I think evolved over the course of the last couple of years, you could say that that also has to do with North Korea as well. What's the gap between that and ending North Korea as you propose?
Well, the division of North Korea into South Korea in 1945 was intended to be temporary.
Right.
Just as we've seen the division between East and West Germany end. But for decades, American leaders in both parties have just routinely accepted that this hereditary communist dictatorship has to be the strangest form of government on earth today is just going to go on forever. And I think we need to begin with a psychological and political change that we do not accept North Korea as a legitimate state. And I think cooperation between South Korea and Japan and the U.S. is a big step toward it. The policy is simple, but not one that the administrations, Republican or Democratic, have been willing to follow, which is even more significant sanctions against North Korea and the determination and making it clear to both China and Russia that we expect that we're going to do what we said we'd do in 1945 and bring the regime back into unification with the South. If we don't focus on the policy, it won't happen.
You worked in the Trump administration, but have since been very critical of the way that Trump has interacted with, courtship with, if you will, Kim and Putin. I'm interested in your take on how one of his Republican competitors in the primary, Vivek Ramaswamy, chose to not answer questions about whether he thinks Putin is a war criminal, because it reminds me of some questions that then-President Trump was asked about Putin. Here's that exchange with reporters yesterday in New Hampshire.
Well, joining us now is former Trump National Security Advisor John Bolton. Ambassador Bolton, thanks for joining us. The actual news itself, the possibility of a meeting between Kim Jong-un and President Putin and Kim leaving North Korea to travel to Russia, what does that tell you?
Well, I think this is a big win for Kim Jong-un and the North Koreans in virtually every respect, certainly in the PR aspect of it, but in the ties that it will help increase between North Korea and Russia. It's mutually beneficial to both in Russia getting weapons and ammunition. It opens the possibility of a kind of conveyor belt. If China doesn't want to supply weapons directly, it can supply them to North Korea, and then lo and behold, they could then in turn be supplied to Russia. But from Kim's point of view, for years and years of being dependent on China, for example, people estimate North Korea gets 90% of its oil from China. Now he's got a real possibility to open up oil and gas coming from Russia. And in this complex relationship,